Hey guys, it's Wednesday, and I'm Andy Friedman, licensed professional clinical counselor and a certified domestic violence counselor. I'm driving to go pick my son up from my mom's. She has been watching him and doing homeschool with him a few days, so I'll pick him up. But I'm really lucky to have such a great support system that I can rely on during times like these. But anyhow, so today the topic is going to be, what if I'm the toxic one? Or what if I'm the crazy one? Or what if it's my character defects that are the problem? Or what if it's my PTSD that's the problem? So I hear this a lot when we're working with clients who are navigating life in recovery from abuse, and you know, often it's brought up, but maybe it's me, you know, maybe I'm the one that isn't seeing it clearly, maybe I'm being selfish, maybe I'm being ungrateful, maybe it's me. And so then that person will wind up in my office seeking help or therapy because they're willing to look at their issues and address them in order to be better friends, sisters, partners, mothers, employees to everyone else around them. But they'll be in real life toxic circumstances, experiencing real life toxic situations, but be talking themselves out of that on the regular. That no, it's not that, it's me. So somebody that I work with had, if I would do this video, I made one a while back, which you could probably find if you just Googled, what if I'm the toxic one? I think that's what it's called. Anyway, so to be fair, let's just start at the beginning. What does toxic mean? Well, it means unhealthy. It means dysfunctional. It means harmful, possibly. It means manipulative. It means there's an imbalance of, you know, who's giving resources, who's taking resources. Toxic can mean a bunch of different things. Toxic could be something just that has to do with a lifestyle that, you know, doesn't agree with you. For example, if you're dating someone and their lifestyle is that they want to go and do and be extroverted and involved and going places all the time, which we can't really do right now, but normally would be out and about all the time doing things, and you're someone that just is not the way that you want to live. If you're forcing yourself to try to live that way, that can be toxic, and that other person isn't doing anything wrong. It's just you're not able to set your own boundaries, or you're, for whatever reason, trying to force yourself to fit into something that you don't fit into at this time in your life for whatever reason. And we've all done that, especially with relationships, especially with toxic relationships. We'll force ourselves to push past our level of discomfort, thinking that that discomfort is a sign that we have an issue. So, all right, here's a story that might illustrate this a little better. Let's see. There's a single mom with a young child who barely, you know, makes enough money and has some support, but really truly is in it on her own, supporting her daughter. And then the bio dad, sperm donor, is one thing that happened right as soon as the pregnancy was revealed, is that that person fled and moved to the other side, as far away from this person as he could. So he made a decision that he didn't want to be around, basically. but then will sort of swoop in and play dad from time to time, but never in ways that are truly helpful. Okay, so here we have a young woman who, you know, works her ass off and tries her hardest and does everything she can to get resources for herself and for her child, making sure that their needs are met and attended to, and is just a really lovely person, caring, lovely person. And again, doesn't have much, is working her ass off. In the meantime, Bio Dad is gallivanting around, having a great time and dating and travels, you know, and then he'll swoop in here and there for some Facebook opportunities, so he can post pictures of him visiting his child and look what a good dad he is and blah blah blah. But while he's visiting, doesn't do anything that's helpful, doesn't ask what the needs are, how can I be of service. You know, it's more, I'm here to make myself feel better, sort of a thing. So anyway, just want to give you a little background there. So recently, this person is not able to work now because what she does for a living, she can't do because of the situation that we're in. So she's definitely hurting for money. And, you know, I think it was last year at the child's birthday, she bought the child something. Let's just say it's a dollhouse. So a dollhouse was purchased by mom, and that was a big gift, and it took a lot for her to save up for, and that was a big deal to her to give that to her daughter. Well, so recently, Bio Dad, oh, by the way, I have permission to share these things. Bio Dad, he wanted to send a gift, and you know, the mom was saying, well, here are some things that we need, that would be nice. And knowing that also this person does not pay child support, you know, so she's like, here's some things that we could really use, you know, if you're wanting to buy gifts and do stuff. And of course, he doesn't choose any of the things that she suggests. And instead, what he does is he sends a bigger and better dollhouse. Now the dollhouse is 3 times the size as the dollhouse that the mom bought. Now, remember, they're living in a situation where they don't really have a lot, and so there's not a lot of room. And this is a huge item that has arrived, and also is very expensive. And now the daughter sees it, and of course the daughter wants it, and the daughter knows it came from daddy. So now daddy has just overshadowed and undermined the mom on her, you know, things that gifts she was trying to give. He wastes the money, basically waving money in her face, just blowing that is a duplication, you know. So wasting money, not getting what was suggested that they need. She spent hours putting it together and now has no room at all to even walk in that room, which is her room. So, all right. So she's thinking how angry she is about this gift and that what a jerk, you know. But at the same time, it was a nice thing, and the little girl loves the dollhouse. So here's this person, pure type lady, and she's telling herself that the reason she's irritated by the gift is because there's something wrong with her, and she's being ungrateful, nitpicking, controlling, bossy, that it's just a matter of that, you know, she just doesn't want him to have a win, and so that makes her petty. So, I'm having to say, but do you see how that was a huge imposition? do you see how that was actually really super selfish? Do you see how that person monopolized your time? Do you see how it made you feel like crap? And you know, of course, yeah, I see those things, but it's me, right? I should just change the way that I look at it. This is what she's thinking. So the reason I'm telling the story is just that's an illustration of a perfect example of narcissistic abuse, where it's very hard to put your finger on, and it looks like a good gesture, like a nice gesture that, well, at least he's doing something nice for the kid. And then, of course, you know, he feels great about himself, but what it did was nothing. It didn't help at all. If anything, it was really just geared to poke at her and undermine her, and make himself feel good. So that's the essence of narcissistic abuse right there. But to someone who, you know, it's an untrained eye, who's not familiar with narcissistic abuse, it's us asking ourselves the question, maybe I'm the toxic one. It was really nice of him to buy the dollhouse. Maybe I should just be grateful for the dollhouse. You know, it's easier to try to figure out what's going on with us, because we can fix that, right? Like, we work on ourselves. And so if we figure out what the problem is, I'll fix it, I'll work on it. But that's not how narcissistic abuse works. Because it's not originating from you. So there's really nothing to fix. It's not that we don't work on ourselves, we do, definitely. But the reason that this young woman is feeling frustrated, pissed off, ignored, invisible, and undermined is because that's the way she was treated, in a very surreptitious way, in a very sneaky way, that if she says that out loud to the wrong person, makes her feel and seem like that she's difficult, and that, you know, she's just got it in for him. And that's not the case at all. So in terms of, you know, am I the toxic one? Am I the problem? You know, we can come up with a real easy way to check on that. And you can create little checklists for yourself to check yourself. You know, am I acting out of anger right now? Have I exercised my planned pause before responding? You know, there's ways to see if where you are with things, right? And truly, if, you know, maybe you're in a position of not seeing it clearly, we can check on those things. But usually these instinctive responses in the moment, that's really the information we want. It's that first gut punch feeling, you know, when the dollhouse arrived and your heart just sunk through your stomach, there's information there. You know, that's not somebody being picky. That's, oh wow, my boundaries have been crossed. I don't even know what to say about this because it's a freaking dollhouse and it's beautiful and my daughter's gonna love it. But also, huh? You know, and that's just a perfect example of narcissistic abuse, and also a perfect example of how ongoing narcissistic abuse winds up shifting the blame, shifting the focus by doing type manipulative tactics that on the outside makes the person look like a good person, but the people who are really involved know that that was actually a slap in the face. And then for the target, they're stuck, you know, and they're isolated in that knowledge, because if they say those things, it proves them, the narcissist, right. Right? Because that's the reactive abuse part of it, is that they do things that make you upset, that make you feel out of character, that make you want to do things that are out of character for you. They poke, prod, mess with you, you know, screw with your mind. They ignore boundaries. They ignore your needs. You're not heard or understood. And yet somehow they're magically able to make you feel like, so if you're experiencing that, like, well, my eyes tell me that this was wrong, but I'm having like all these mixed feelings, that just means that there's a good chance that something's going on, you know, that isn't on the up and up, that perhaps there is some manipulation happening. And I know that we don't want to be paranoid, and I'm not saying that, but I am saying that at a certain point we have to start listening to our instincts and listening to our gut. And when you get an uh-oh feeling or this isn't right feeling, there's a good chance because you're having the feeling because it isn't right and that something is going on. I don't know if this is helpful or not. I just know that there's a lot of people that spend so much time trying to correct themselves when really it's their circumstance or situation or the people around them that aren't treating them with respect, aren't treating them as humans. You know, that inevitably ends with the target feeling like they're the problem. And, you know, I just over and over see that, and I just want to grab the person and hug them and say, you're not the problem. You're not the problem. I would feel how you feel too. That wasn't cool for him to buy that dollhouse and overshadow the thing you saved up for last week. That wasn't last year. That wasn't right for him to ignore the things that you actually need for your child, and buy something that's a duplicate. You know, it's just, it's not right. And so if you're feeling like that, it might be because it's true. Yeah. Okay. That was my rant.